University grade, and myself are really pleased to welcome this early evening Georgia Pliaku to talk to us on the ancient city of Gitana, the full title being Revealing an Urban and Political Center in Thesprotia, Northwestern Greece. For those of you who are not familiar with the acronym ARVA, this is the International Association for Archaeological Research in Western and Central Asia. And one of the branches of its annual lectures is about the Aegean and the Southwestern Balkan area. So we're happy that this year the ARVA administration has entrusted the organization of a series of lectures to Zorica and myself. And until the very beginning of July, one lecture per Monday is presented. All presentations are recorded and they are available on the ARVA main page. So a few words about our speaker today. Georgia Pliaku earned her PhD from the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki in 2007. Is currently head of the Department of Prehistoric and Classical Antiquities at Museums and Deputy Director at the Ephorate of Antiquities of Thesprotia, one of the sections of the Hellenic Ministry of Culture and Sports. Georgia conducted and supervised numerous excavations in the regions of ancient Ambrakia, modern Arta, Lefkas, Ioannina, and Thesprotia, and was head of the Committee for the Supervision of the Project Restoration and Preservation Works at the Asian Theater of Gitana, carried out in the framework of the Regional Operational Program Epirus 2014-2020. She is the author of the monograph «Το Λεκανοπέδιο των Ιωαννίνων και η ευρύτερη περιοχή της Μολωσίας στην Κεντρική Ήπειρο, Αρχαιολογικά Κατάλοιπα, Οικιστική Οργάνωση και Οικονομία», which should be the location of Ioannina and the broader region of the Molossi in central Epirus, archaeological remains, settlement patterns, and economy, after her dissertation at Thessaloniki in 2007. Georgia is also the author of a number of articles on archaeological topography, settlement patterns, and ceramics from several Epiro sites. So it is a pleasure to welcome Georgia this late afternoon, early evening, and offer the floor to her speech. Thank you, Georgia.
Thank you very much, Professor Vlachopoulos, dear Andreas, and Professor Kuzmanovich, dear Zorita, for inviting me to join the lecture series so far, and for this introduction, of course. I'm very happy that I have the opportunity to present here a significant yet unknown ancient city, also another aspect, a developing archaeological site, which is hidden in the northwestern corner of Greece, as you already can see in the picture. Before starting my presentation, I would like to point out that the ancient city of Gitana is not my research field. The site has been excavated for years, as it is known perhaps, by the emeritus director of the local Ephorate of Antiquities, Mrs. Calliope Perekali, several other scholars were engaged with specific topics, as for example, the fortification and the cemetery of the city. Being responsible for the protection and promotion of this archaeological site, I have to deal with all archaeological information related to it. Therefore, what I will present you today is a synthesis based on the so far published data about the site. I'm trying to change the excuse me, but I can change it with the
You can't change slides.
Okay. I did it.
Okay.
So, the ancient city of Gitana is located in the modern region of Epirus, a short distance from the Greek-Albanian border. In antiquity, the area was part of ancient Epirus, which extended on the northwestern part of Greece, as well as on the southernmost part of Albania, along the Ionian Adriatic coastline. According to Theopompus, 14 different ethne, that is tribal peoples, inhabited Epirus. Strabo lists 11 of them, among which the Chaonians, the Thesprotians, and the Cassopeians are described to have sailed the coastal zone from the Ceraunian Mountains to the Ambracian Gulf, having a fertile land. The Thesprotians, the mainland opposite Corcyra, goes back to the 5th century BC and appears in the writings of Thucydides. A more detailed outline of the Thesprotian coastline topography was further provided by Strabo. Based on the accounts of the ancient written sources, the territory of ancient Thesprotia can be accurately defined. In the south, the Acheron River formed the frontier with Cassopea. The northern border of Thesprotia, marked by the Thiamis River by the time of Thucydides, seems to have moved northwards before the middle of the 4th century BC, probably as far as the river Pavla, and this change likely coincides with the founding of Gitana. The city extends on the foot of the Vrisella Mountain within an area of special natural beauty close to the Kalamas River, the ancient Thiamis, which surrounds the settlement on three sides. The city was located roughly 8 kilometers from the Ionian coastline, which was easily accessible via the river. A large part of the riverbed beyond the coast was navigable in antiquity, allowing the transport of people and goods. The site was naturally fortified, as it is protected by the river's meanders and the steep mountain slope. Near its summit, a defense tower offered a perfect panoramic view and visual contact of the fertile deltaic plain and the coastal fortifications of Mastilitsa, Pyrgos Ragiou, and Lyon. Ancient literary sources mentioning the name of the city, the toponym, are very poor. The first reference is by Polybius. A second reference to the city appears in Livy. In his narration of the events of the Third Macedonian War, the Roman historian mentions an assembly of the Epirotes held at Gitana, which was at a distance of 10 Roman miles from the sea. After its abandonment, the city's name seems to have been forgotten over the centuries, receiving at some time the name Paleo-Venetia. In the beginning of the 19th century, François Pouqueville, based on a previous historical map on which the name Gitane was correctly marked, suggested that the remains he had visited on the bank of Thiamis should be identified as the city of Gitana mentioned by Livy. So we have the first identification of the city, of the name with the remains of the city. Years later, the name of the city was confirmed by excavation findings. Valuable information about the social, political, and religious organization of the city of Gitana and of the Thesprotians is provided by a manumission inscription discovered in the vicinity of Gitana and first published by Sotirios Dakaris in Archaeological Delteon. It refers to the manumission of the slave Phalacros from his master Xenes. As evidenced by the inscription, at the head of the Thesprotians was a prostatas, a position equivalent to that of the eponymous archon, a chief magistrate, while the reference to Themis confirms the worship of the goddess in Gitana. Having dated the inscription in the mid-4th century, Sotiris Dakaris, Nicholas Hammond, and Pierre Caban, which were the pioneers of the archaeological and historical research on ancient Epirus, suggested that the Thesprotian ethne were unified, were organized into a koinon, a league, during this period, about the mid-4th century, with Gitana to be their political center. Further epigraphical evidence about the koinon of the Thesprotians is provided by a bronze inscription from Dodona. This inscription names the koinon of the Thesprotians, while the inscription from Gitana names the prostatas of the Thesproton, of the Thesproti. The first archaeological survey in Gitana was carried out by the curator of antiquities of Epirus, Photios Petsas, who visited the site in 1946 and filed a brief report in Archaeologική Εφημερή some years later, in 1955. Limited rescue excavations were carried out in the early 60s by Sotiris Dakaris, to whom the manumission inscription had been offered. The visible remains of Gitana were further described by Nicholas Hammond, you see the picture on the left, in his book Epirus, and finally a detailed and accurate plan of the city's remains under the direction of Sotiris Dakaris was included in his fundamental monograph with the title Thesprotia, published in 1972.
Sorry you're here to interrupt. Could we please all mute our microphones? Thank you.
I can hear anything, but you do, I suppose. Okay. Shall I continue? Wide-scale excavations at Gitana did not begin until the mid-80s. I must highlight here the major contribution of Dr. Calliope Peck Alexandri, who was director of the local Forest of Antiquities for more than 20 years, conducting rescue excavations since 1985, and directing a program of systematic archaeological research in the following years. Calliope Peck brought to light most of the public buildings of the city and part of the ancient cemetery. She is also the author of most of the published works about the rich archaeological material of the site. The remains of the city were further uncovered during co-financed projects. The removal of vegetation and surface soil revealed the outlines of numerous buildings. You can see in the picture down and on the right, leading to a new topographic documentation which complemented the topographic plan of Sotiris Dakaris. As regards the chronological span of the habitation, according to research so far, Gitana was most likely founded in the second half of the 4th century, with the earliest finding to be a late 4th century grave assemblage. A red figure lithos and a pseudo-Cypriot type unguentarium are among the offerings. Apart from that, a thorough study on the fortification suggests its dating in the same period. However, the area's advantageous position contributed to its habitation as early as prehistoric times, as indicated by the discovery of handmade pottery in the cemetery area. Additionally, few sporadic ceramic fragments of the late 5th, early 4th century found in the lowest layers beneath the building's foundation indicate that the area was already inhabited before the official founding of the city and the construction of its walls. Unfortunately, I have no photos to show you. Most of the pottery vessels and numismatic issues date to the 3rd and 2nd centuries, testifying that the city flourished in this period, while local pottery workshops have also been attested. Finally, significant findings confirm that after the Roman conquest in 168, the city continued to be inhabited without any signs of decline until the last decades of the 1st century BC, as we will see next, more in detail. Let's now proceed with the description of the city. The settlement extends to the Pessius Plateau with its slopes at an altitude of 30 to 80 meters. It is surrounded on all sides by a strong fortification wall with a total perimeter of 2,500 meters, which encloses an area of 28 hectares. The wall surrounds not only the residential core of the city, but also the slopes of the Vizela mountain, resulting in a horseshoe-shaped large catapult tower. Here, a partition wall, which served as a second line of defense, runs from north to south, dividing the settlement into two large residential areas, the so-called upper city and the so-called lower city. Based on the masonry and the type of towers, it has been suggested by Christos Panodimos that this partition wall was constructed about a century later than the main fortification in the last decades of the century BC. As regards its urban organization, Gitana had a design in zones, a variant of the Hippodamian system adapted to the sloping natural terrain. The streets were straight and crossed each other at right angles, creating elongated building blocks or insula, which are in average 15 to 17 meters wide and 35 meters in length. Each building block, comprised two or more buildings, while large buildings, whether public or private, could occupy an entire block. The streets were surfaced with compressed soil, although some sections were stone paved. The main paved road through the agora led to the eastern riverside gate, where harbor facilities were likely located. Private houses in Gitana have not been systematically excavated, so there is no sufficient data on their architectural types. In contrast, we have a much clearer picture of the public buildings on which focused the research of pre-Alexandria. The Agora of Gitana occupied a position on a plateau to the northeast of the partition wall. Formed as an open area, it was bordered on the one side by a large stoa and on the other by a complex of shops. You can see the stoa here and the shops. Stretching 76 meters in length and 11 meters in width, the store was one of the city's largest buildings. It belongs to the very common type in northwestern Greece, with the side walls extending to the edges of the facade, known here as Stoas Antre Couture. The building had a Doric colonnade in the facade and an Ionic one in the interior. Of particular interest is a series of rectangular and cylindrical pedestals discovered in front of the building. They were likely intended for the display of votive offerings and to honor prominent citizens, as indicated by the engraved inscriptions they bore, as well as by bronze fragments, probably from statues. This extremely significant material witnesses for the political character of the stoa alongside its commercial one. I could also say that close similarities can be observed with the Hellenistic North Stoa of Cassopi, of the city of Cassopi, and the Stoa of Dodona. I reserve to say more about this extremely important monument. Its study and publication are currently being prepared by the excavator. Among the finds from the building, I will briefly mention the numerous coins, including a hoard of 250 coins issued by the Epirot Koinon, additionally, a significant number of iron tools, weapons, bronze and clay vessels were discovered, shedding light on the commercial activity that took place in the city. Furthermore, plenty of trade amphoras dating to the late 2nd and 3rd centuries BC and originating from the Ionian Adriatic zone confirm strong commercial relations with the Italian peninsula and Sicily following the Roman conquest of Epirus. The amphorae from Gitana, first published by Pre-Calexandri, are currently being studied more in detail by Guillermo Pasquale Berlanga. Thank you once more, Guillermo, for this picture. As regards worship and the religious architecture in Gitana, a small temple uncovered along the main road that led to the Britanneion provides valuable information. It consists of a cella and a pronaos with two Doric columns between the ante, being a sole exception to the common form of a simple oikos which characterizes the sacred landscape in Thesprotia. Several finds of the building reveal the identity of the worship deity. According to the dedicator inscription preserved on the base of a female statue, a young woman with the name Phila or Philo dedicated the statue to Parthenos. The statue has been attributed to the type of Pudicitia and dated to the second half of the 2nd century BC, that means after the Roman conquest. The name of Parthenos, along with the name of the city, also appear in a bronze inscription that mentioned the manumission of the young boy Nicomachos, who was then dedicated to Parthenos by his grandmother. A dedication both to Parthenos and Themis was suggested by Pierre Caban. The inscription was dated in the 5th century BC, so these two findings testify and witness that also the religious buildings continued their function during the two last centuries and after the Roman conquest of Epirus. The worship of Themis in Gitana, already known from the manumission inscription of Phalacros that we have seen at the beginning, according to a different approach, was housed in another building, where a roof tile fragment with the letters Emit from the word Themit was found. Finally, the worship of Apollos Agios has been recognized in a building adjacent to the North Stoa, with an obeliscus fragment to have been associated as a symbol of the deity. Other buildings with potential public character have also been uncovered, but not yet investigated, in the so-called Lower City. Let us now move on to the most important building of the city, which has been identified as the city's Britanneion Archive. Located at the junction of two main roads, between the temple and the theater, the building had a monumental entrance with a propylon. You can see here a 3D digital representation, which has recently been produced to be used in visual tools by portable devices in situ in the archaeological site. Covering an area of 1,500 square meters, the Britanneum, the building included rooms for symposia, banquets, the so-called Andrones in ancient sources, warehouses, and auxiliary rooms arranged around the central courtyard. The Andrones were decorated with mosaic floors, depicting, among other things, the well-known Macedonian star. I don't know if you can see it in the picture down and in the right. A number of couches, anaclitra, would have been arranged alongside the walls, as evidenced from the decorative couch fittings, mostly known as fulcra, found there. The building also housed the city's archive, where papyrus scrolls of public correspondence were kept, as evidenced by an extremely important assemblage of more than 3,000 clay ceilings which were found there. At least 14 ceilings bear the name of the city, Gitana, while public emblems with the name of the Thesprotian, Therapiotethne, Molossians, Chaonians, and state formations, the Epirot Koinon, political functions, parliament, vouli, voula, parliament, are common. Public officials, such as Agoranomos, a Mark Overseer, Grammateus, a secretary, and Agogeus, district attorney, also appear. Other ceilings bear depictions of gods, heroes, and mythical creatures, animals, birds, and plants. Of interest is also the frequent depiction of Macedonian temples, which confirm the close ties between Epirus and the Macedonian kingdom. The ceilings from the Prytaneion of Gitana apparently provide a wealth of information about the political and administrative organization of the Thesprotians, the relations with other cities and kingdoms, and other things, and many other things, and we are looking forward to seeing their publication. The most impressive among the buildings of the city is the theater. It is the unique theater in ancient Thesprotia, a fact that also highlights the special importance of the city of Gitana as a political center for the Thesprotians. I would like to stress here that in the wider region of ancient Epirus, Hellenistic theaters existed in the sanctuary of Dodona, which was a political center for the Molossians and for the Epirot Koinon, as well as in the cities of Kasopi and in Phoenike, which were centers for the Kasopias and the Chaonians, respectively. Built in the 3rd century BC, the theater is located outside the western fortification walls. You can see here the wall of the city. And next to the Thiamis River, which would have provided direct access for those who arrived by boat. Although it was placed outside the walls, a separate branch of the fortification reached the banks of the river, forming a tower which ensured both control and protection. This is the branch of the fortification wall, which reaches almost the bank of the river. Apart from performances of ancient drama, political gatherings were probably held here, either by the Thesprotians or by the Epirot Koinon, since it has been assumed that the assembly mentioned by Livy might have taken place in the theater. Facing west and overlooking the river, the koilon is divided into two sections by a diazoma, a horizontal passageway, while eight staircases separated radially into seven sections of seats, kerkides. It consisted of 29 rows of seats, and it is estimated that it had a capacity of approximately 4,000 spectators. The orchestra was arranged in an arc with a radius of 7.5 meters exceeding the half circle. A distinct feature of the theater is that some of the Hedolian staircase steps were hewn directly into the rock. The stage building was two stories high, and in the middle of the ground floor were five octagonal pillars which supported the wooden floor of the Logaion, formed by 12 Doric semicolumns with conjoint pillars. The colonnade of the proscenium carried a compact Ionic entablature. Two rectangular oblong structures that are poorly preserved on either side of the proscenium, initially interpreted as parascenia side buildings, have recently been associated with the sloping corridors that ascended to the floor of the Logaion, with parallels in the theater of Cassopi and the theater of Stratos in Acarnania. A unique and very impressive feature of the theater is the engraving of names on the foreheads of most of the Hedonia. More than 150 names were recognized, such as Alexandros, Nicanor, Menedamos, Kephalos, Phalakrion, and the women Damoxena, Materina, Philista, Damonoa, Satira, denoting the act of manumission of slaves by their masters. The names of the owners were written in the nominative case, while those of the slaves were in the accusative. There were often more than one masters, who were probably relatives. You can see in the stone this Hedolio, Kephalos, Timodamos, two names. Probably they were relatives, we don't know it. We have another word, Kephalos, Timodamos, Pamphilos. Here we have an example, this is for Ilias mostly. Pamphilos, we have an example that the name is accompanied with an ethnic. Pamphilos is one of the smaller ethne, Thesprosian ethne, that constituted the ethnos of Thesproti. And the slave is Krateros. Kephalos, Τιμόδαμος, Pamphilos, the ethnic, Krateron, the name of the slave. I suppose you can see. It's very moving that we can read in situ inside the settlement of Gitana about 2,000 personal names of the inhabitants, citizens and liberated women and men. What is equally interesting is that numerous women appear as masters emancipating slaves without any mention of their father or husband's name, a fact denoting a distinct social position of women in Epirus. I would like also to remind here that manumissions by Epirot women as masters also appear in the Sanctuary of Dodona and in the Theatre of Buthrotos in Albania, in Chaonia. I will finally try to briefly give some information about the cemeteries and burial practices. The cemetery of Gitana was situated outside the fortification wall along the road that led to the main gate, while another part extended across the riverbank. Graves of various types, usually with a similar orientation and arranged in clusters, represent the special organization in the cemetery. Small enclosures around a single grave, usually cist grave, and more elaborate enclosures containing family burials or seed. As far as burial practices are concerned, it is quite interesting that during the Hellenistic period in Thesprosia, cremation is dominant, although inhumation is not completely absent yet, with fewer examples. I should additionally point out that in some cases inside the large cist graves there were no inhumations, but only cinerary urns and grave offerings, a practice which is also known from the cemetery of Foidiae in Chaonia. Besides, the orthogonal Naiskos flag urns also find parallels in funerary complexes of Chaonia. These common burial practices testify to the close cultural and also commercial relations with the neighboring northern regions of ancient Epirus. To sum up, what has been discussed above represents only part of the abundant archaeological evidence provided by the research in the ancient city of Hydena. And I would like to point out that the major part of the city has not yet been excavated. I hope, however, that the material presented here has succeeded in sketching the picture of an extremely important Epirot city. Although situated at the corner of the Greek territory, Gitana has nowadays become an organized archaeological site endowed with a surrounding landscape of incredible beauty. I will therefore complete this lecture providing some information on the enhancement and restoration works that have been carried out, as well as on the future promotion prospects. I have already mentioned the implemented projects, which not only have improved the visitors' experience, but also contributed to the expansion of knowledge within the scientific community. After the completion of the above works, which made almost the entire archaeological site accessible to the public, care was focused on the restoration of the theater. The project was included in the operational program Epirus 2014-2020 with the co-financial support of the European Union. At the very beginning, special care was given to the topographical and architectural documentation and photogrammetric 3D mapping, as well as to the preparation of the necessary geotechnical, architectural and restoration studies. The implementation of our project was undertaken by a multidisciplinary team. All of the works were carried out according to the principles of reversibility and taking into account the new archaeological evidence revealed during the project, with the aim being to match as closely as possible the original layout and geometry of the monument. The restoration of the three central kerkides of the Koilon included the removal of the hedonia and footrests that were fractured and fragmented, their rejoining using titanium rods, and their repositioning after their restoration. A new forthcoming program will comprise restoration works in the rest of the monument. In the last year, emphasis is also placed on increasing the number of visitors. Last but not least, the completion of our project was linked to the reviving of the theater and of the archaeological site. In the summer of 2020, a music performance took place in the theater about 2,000 years after the final abandonment of Hydena. Henceforth, the monument has been hosting cultural performances every year, embodying our motto. By breathing new life into the monuments, they become high places of cultural enlightenment as they once were centuries ago. Thank you very much for your attention and your patience.